Right, hello and welcome to week 15. So we have made it to the end of the semester. This is the last class. All right. So first off, way to go, guys. Today what we're going to be doing is a brief overview of what's coming up this week. And then we're going to be looking at a final exam overview. All right. So first off, we're here at the end of the semester. So congratulations on getting through the class. You guys rock. You made it. Okay, so for your information, December 4th is the deadline lockdown date for the following. Okay, first off, weekly discussion board. That comes up due on December 4th because it will lock at that point and you will not be able to make any more posts. Okay, so there are 14 topics up there. That is where we're going to leave it. We're not going to try to do a week 15 topic because you won't have enough time to respond to it. Okay, so weekly discussion board, make sure you have as many responses as you can get in before December 4th. Second, MindTap. Everything in MindTap marked counts for grade needs to be completed by December 4th because that too will lock down. Okay, and all that stuff that counts for grade is all stuff that should auto grade. So as soon as you complete it, you should know what your grade is on it. Okay. Number three, the proposal essay. That is coming up due on December 4th. That is what you should be workshopping right now. This week is the proofreading and editing workshop on that essay. Now, the link will open up on December 3rd, that is Thursday. December 4th is the actual deadline. Unfortunately, I don't have a lot of leeway in terms of late turn-ins on this, so you will need to have it in by December 10th at the latest. That's the absolute latest I can accept anything, because the next day I have to submit grades. Okay, so I cannot accept anything turned in after the 10th of October. Fourth here, anybody that wants to do a corrections on classical argument and evaluation essays. If you want to try to improve those for a better grade, that needs to be got. You need to get those to me by December 4th. Okay, that is a hard deadline on that. I'm not going to accept any of those any later than December 4th. Okay. This week will be the final Blackboard Collaborate session for the semester. It will be on Thursday as usual. This session is not going to involve slides. It's going to be entirely question and answer. Okay. So you guys are going to have. You're going to want to bring all the questions that you need to have answered to that session so that you can be ready to answer, have them answered for you. Okay? Final exam. Final exam links for the exam itself will open up at midnight on Monday, which is December 7th. Okay? There will be a folder in the final exam tab containing the PowerPoints of the selected questions plus the actual exam link. Okay, so what you need to do is find the right PowerPoint, and you need to find the link that for the turn in the exam. Open up the PowerPoint, get your questions, write out your responses, and turn it in through the exam link. Okay, so today what we're going to be doing is a final overview of the final exam materials. It's going to be primarily a review of the packet and question overviews. If you missed them the first time, this is a prime opportunity to get this information. Okay? So if you did not watch the lectures and missed the Collaborate sessions for weeks 10 and 12, this is the exam final exam stuff that we covered those 2 weeks. Okay? With maybe a little bit more information than what you had before. All right, so. Real quick here, final exam topic for this time around, children's television censorship. Always under intense scrutiny, children's television can sometimes veer into areas where general adult audiences become more uncomfortable with subject matter. Reactions to these ventures into the wilderness can vary on a local or national scale, but many times when the ire of the adults thinking of the children is raised, it leads to the censorship or wholesale change to individual episodes or even entire series. Okay? There is no usual suspects when it comes to what causes controversy or what shows it appears on. The only commonality is that sometimes something angers a potentially powerful membership of the audience and leads to banning of episodes, cutting of scenes, or in some cases, changing characters. Okay? The issues causing controversy change over time, ranging from issues with violent content and overtly offensive behavior to uncomfortable social movements such as civil rights movement, LGBTQIA+ rights, so on and so forth, and uncomfortable societal ills such as mass incarceration, the opioid crisis, and so on. Okay? So, these are all things to consider that are the reasons why children's television gets challenged. Reasoning for controversy. The list from Looper tends to cover most of the reasons behind children's TV causing controversy in general. Okay? We have seven basic categories that a lot of these complaints fall into and a lot of these banned episodes fall into. Okay? One of them is violence. That involves, for example, Gargoyle's Deadly Force. Okay? We have offensive content and language. In this case, rude removal from Dexter's Laboratory and Buffalo Gals from Cow and Chicken. We have physical harm to viewers. This would be Electric Soldier Porygon from Pokemon, the original Japanese Pokemon. We have excessive death portrayals. This would include the episode One Beer from Tiny Toon Adventures and Day of Destiny from Sailor Moon. Okay. Offensive religious content. The entirety of the Garbage Pail Kids series falls under this, as well as the episode See Me, Feel Me, Know Me from the Powerpuff Girls. Overt sexual content. In this case, the episodes The Mask of Matches Malone from Batman, The Brave and the Bold, and Hot Springs Planet 10 Ray from Outlaw Star. And then promoting antisocial behavior, example they give is Stokey the Bear from Dudley Do-Right. We have a case study here of the episode Deadly Force from Gargoyles. From the first season, this is from the first season of Disney's Gargoyles, the episode's the eighth of the season. So the plot line of the episode centers on guilt felt by the Gargoyle Broadway after he accidentally shoots the Gargoyle's human ally, Police Detective Lisa Mazza, with her own gun in her apartment when he was playing cowboy with it. The episode originally aired in syndication, but was removed from rotation when it appeared on Disney-owned cable networks, such as Toon Disney and Disney XD. Other networks that showed the series digitally removed blood from the scene when Lisa was shot. The episode was restored to the series in 2013 for its DVD collection release. In 2019, the series was made available for streaming on Disney Plus with the episode in its proper place in the season 1 rotation. However, the shooting scene shown above is recut to avoid showing Elisa bleeding. Okay? Now, I have the pertinent scenes from this episode that will kind of show you what the point was of the episode as well as the controversial scene that caused this to get cut. Okay? So, as I've mentioned here before, the entire point of this episode was a public service announcement in regards to children trying to teach them not to play with guns, okay? And it also serves as a lesson for parents on what to do with your guns to keep them away out of children's hands, okay? So, first, we got four clips here. The four clips from the episode that I've chosen are all ones that involve Elisa herself, the incident that occurs, the shooting, and then the three times when the episode goes back to her in the hospital, okay? Because they tried to do it very realistically in terms of her recuperation. So, let's look at Deadly Force. First part of it is the actual shooting and the reasoning for it, okay? All right, so just to establish here, the reason why Broadway is playing with the gun in the first place is because in this episode he's become enamored with a Western movie which uses an awful lot of gunplay, and he's trying to emulate some of the stuff that he sees in the movie, but as you'll see, he's trying to do it with Elisa's gun, which she happens to leave hanging off of a coat rack. Second case study is Sesame Street, the entire series. The gold standard of American children's television, Sesame Street is currently in its 50th season, now shared between its original home on PBS and its current home on HBO. Sesame Street has earned no shortage of criticism over how issues have been portrayed on the show. The loudest and most harsh criticism has involved portrayals of social issues such as multiculturalism and societal ills. The show has introduced characters over the years who introduce children to these societal concepts, usually in response to criticisms, and have integrated them into the show's overall storyline. So, some of the examples of this that we want to take a look at here, I actually have the links so I can show you these clips. Roosevelt Franklin was brought in to deal with racial integration. Abby Cadabby deals with parental divorce. Julia is an autistic Muppet. Alex has incarcerated parents. Lily deals with hunger, poverty, and eventually homelessness. Kami from South Africa deals with HIV. And Carly, the most recent character, deals with being in foster care because her parents are opioid addicts. Okay? So I'm going to show you these clips here. Some of them are going to be longer than others, and at least the Julia one, I think I have to cut off after probably about 4 minutes or so because it's a 15-minute clip. But the rest of these are fairly short. Okay, but they will give you an idea of what we're talking about with these issues and how Sesame Street covers them. So starting off with Roosevelt Franklin, who incidentally, if you read the New Yorker article, they tell you that Roosevelt Franklin was intended to be an anti-stereotypical black character. His creator intended him to be someone who was against the stereotypes that you saw of African-American characters on TV at the time. Even though he's still clearly coded as African-American, in fact, some of his speech pattern kind of mirrors AAVE. If you're not familiar with that term, stands for African-American Vernacular English. Which up until a few years back when AAVE became the accepted term, most linguists called it ebonics, which is kind of an offensive term if you think about it. But he talks that way, but he's also a child genius. And in fact, the clip I hear talks about is showing him teaching at his elementary school, as in he founded it, and he is the principal and one of the teachers at it. Okay? So let's take a look at Roosevelt Franklin. For starters, and then we'll go through the rest of these clips.
What's the matter with you?
Yeah, what's ailing you, Susetta?
I'm not talking.
Well, you should talk, you know. Oh, here comes Roosevelt. Here comes Roosevelt.
What's the matter with you?
Nothing. I'm not talking.
You're not talking to me? What did I do to you?
Nothing.
Well, then come on up here and tell me what's wrong.
All right.
Now, what's the matter?
Well, when Hard Head Henry Head called me a cantaloupe head, he hurt my feelings.
Well, why didn't you tell him?
Because I'm not talking to him.
Now, how's he going to know that he hurt your feelings if you don't tell him?
You mean his head is so hard he can't look at me and tell him he hurt my feelings?
Maybe. Anyhow, the best thing to do when somebody hurts your feelings is to let them know that they did it.
Okay. Hard Head Henry Harris, You hurt my feelings.
Oh, I didn't know that.
He didn't know that?
He didn't know that?
Mm-mm. Now, and I bet he's sorry.
He's sorry?
I'm sorry.
See?
Sorry.
All right, so you kind of get the idea of Roosevelt Franklin's character, very much like a child version of your typical elementary school teacher. Okay? Next one. This clip is Abby Cadabby talking about her parents being divorced.
Little children, big challenges, divorce.
Hey, guys! Hey, what you doing?
I'm drawing pictures.
Oh, really? Of what?
Of our homes. Yep. We're drawing where we live.
This is a picture of Elmo's apartment.
This one is where I live with my mommy, and this one is where I live with my daddy.
But, Abby, why don't you all live in one house together?
Well, because my parents are divorced.
Divorced? Mm-hmm. Well, what does divorce mean?
Well, divorce means that Abby's mommy and daddy aren't married anymore.
Elmo's a doesn't get it.
Me neither.
When my mommy and daddy were married, we all lived together in one house. But then one day they told me they had some grown-up problems. Problems they couldn't fix. Mommy and daddy told me that they decided not to be married to each other anymore. But they said they both still love me very much. I've got big feelings, feelings jumbled up inside. I got big feelings, feelings, yeah.
It was hard at first because I knew I wasn't going to see my dad every day. When I'm sad, I usually talk to my mom, and she figures out a way to help me understand what's happening.
It was really hard going through all these changes. Even though my dad doesn't live with us anymore, I still love him. Like, he's always gonna be my daddy.
I still love my mommy and my daddy. And they still love me.
And you know what, Abby? That's something that will never change.
I know.
For more information, visit sesamestreet.org/divorce.
All right. So they try to be a little sensitive about that. Next one is Julia. This is the autism Muppet. One thing I should also note is that Julia caused some consternation within the production company of Sesame Street. In fact, the autism organization that helped to co-developed the character along with Sesame Street eventually cut ties. And I believe it was regarding how Julia's characterization was evolving. But this is basically how Julia was introduced.
Here's some more paper, guys.
Oh, thanks, Alan.
You're welcome.
Okay, just a little more
green. Oh, that's nice.
Thank you.
Oh, hey, welcome to Sesame Street.
Oh,
we are having some fun with finger paints.
Oh, hi, guys. Oh. Hi, Elmo. Hi, Abby.
Hi, Alan.
Hi.
Oh, who's this?
Oh, this is our friend, Julia.
Oh, hi, Julia. I'm Big Bird. Nice to meet you. Oh. Julia?
Julia's just concentrating on her painting right now. You guys, you're all doing a great job.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alan.
You're welcome.
Wait, I'm a lost finger painting.
Yeah, me too. I love the way the paint squishes in my fingers.
Oh, you're right. I'm sorry, Julia. I know you don't like the way it feels.
And that's why a paintbrush works for you. There's lots of ways to paint.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and there.
That was our job. Yep. So am I.
Oh, can I see what you all painted?
Sure.
Oh, wait. You guys, here. Wipe your hands off first.
All right.
And I will show him. Take a look.
Whoa. Those are both really great.
Aw, thank you.
May I see your painting, Julia? Julia?
Sometimes it takes Julia a while to answer. It helps to ask again. Julia? Can Big Bird see your painting?
See your painting? Yes.
Okay. Oh, all right. Take a look at this, everybody.
Oh, wow! A flying bunny car!
Fluffster!
Oh, yeah! That looks just like your bunny, Fluffster!
I love it! Oh, it's so fun and silly. Julia, you're so creative.
Yeah, you're really good at painting. High five, Julia. Huh? Huh? High five? Ellen, I don't think Julia likes me very much.
Oh, no, you two are just meeting for the first time.
Oh, so she's shy. Oh, I get that. I can feel shy sometimes, too.
Well, with Julia, it's not just that. You see, she has autism. Mm. She likes it when people know that.
Autism? Well, what's autism?
Well, for Julia, it means that she might not answer you right away.
Mm. Yeah, Julia doesn't say a lot. Mm-hmm.
That's right. And she may not do what you expect, like give you a high five.
Yeah, she does things just a little differently, in a Julia sort of way.
Oh, okay.
And she's a lot of fun.
Yeah. Oh, Julia likes being with her friends. Oh, and she loves to play, too.
Play.
You want to play now?
That's a great idea.
Oh, me too. Can I play?
Sure, Big Bird.
Okay, so what should we play?
How about tag?
I think that's a yes.
Yeah. Oh, Julia, you're bouncing like a rubber ball. Boing, 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 boing,
boing, boing, boing, boing, boing.
Okay, Julia, one more thing. Tag, you're up.
Wait. What's Julia doing?
Well, it looks like she's playing tag while jumping.
I've never seen tag played like that.
Well, Julia does do some things a little differently.
Oh, because of her autism?
Sometimes people with autism may do things that might seem confusing to you.
Oh, like when she flaps her hands?
Yep, that's just something she does when she's excited. But you know what? Julia also does some things that you might want to try.
Boing, 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 boing! This is fun, Julia!
Hey, it's a whole new game! It's Boing Tag!
All right, we're going to leave it at that, because that's a very extensive clip. But what I will tell you is that eventually, if you continue with that clip, Big Bird accidentally overstims Julia, and she starts having a breakdown, and they have to try to help her through that. Okay, so that was part of the portrayal of autism that they used for the show. All right, so the next clip is Alex, and this is the Muppet who has an incarcerated father. Okay.
Alex, maybe we can get our dads to make cars like that with us. Huh?
Yeah, and then we can race cars together.
Great idea.
I don't think so.
Oh, come on, it would be fun.
Yeah, just ask your daddy.
Well, he can't do it.
He's
not around right now.
Huh? Well, where is he?
Somewhere else.
Oh, did he go on vacation?
Is he visiting someone?
Yeah, where'd he go?
Yeah, where?
Look, I don't want to talk about it. Okay?
Okay, yeah. Did we say something wrong?
I don't know.
He's upset about something. Come on.
Alex! Alex!
Alex?
Alex, are you okay?
You seem kind of sad.
Mm-hmm. Listen, Alex, whatever it is that's on your mind, you don't have to tell us. But we're your friends, and you can always talk to us if you want.
It's just all this talk about my dad and where he is got me really upset.
Oh, because your daddy's away?
And you miss him?
Yeah, but because of where he is, too. My dad's in jail.
In jail?
Why?
I don't like to talk about it. Most people don't understand.
Actually, I do understand what you're going through. When I was about your age, my dad was incarcerated too.
He was?
Wait, what's incarcerated? And why was your dad in it?
Incarcerated is when someone breaks the law, a grown-up rule, and then they have to go to jail or prison.
All right, so you see how they handled Alex. Next one is going to be Lily. This is the impoverished and homeless Muppet.
That looks good, Elmo.
Thank you, Lily.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Our painting is really coming along. Mm-hmm. The three of us are pretty good rainbow makers.
Yeah. Elmo, Sophia, and Lily.
It's almost a rainbow.
Huh?
We've got red and orange and yellow, green, blue. We just need a little more purple.
Yeah, purple.
Hey, it's okay. We'll get some more purple and we'll finish our rainbow.
Yeah.
Lily, are you okay?
Yeah. Why does Lily look so sad?
I'm not sure I want to paint anymore. It doesn't really feel like a rainbow kind of day.
Lily, Elmo and I are your friends, and we're here for you, for anything you want to talk about, anything at all.
You know, Lily, sometimes when Elmo talks about his feelings, it makes Elmo feel better.
It's just that, well, my bedroom is purple, and purple's my favorite color, and it reminds me of my bedroom. And, well, we don't have our own apartment anymore, and we've been staying in all different kinds of places.
Lily, no matter where you are, always remember. The thing about home is more than a house or an apartment. Home is really where the love is. That's why you and your parents are staying with me for a while. And we're gonna make sure that no matter what, there's always lots of love.
Yeah, love.
Oh, and now that I know that you love purple, you can use my special purple bath towel, and you can wear my special purple sweatshirt, and you can use my favorite purple cereal bowl. Yeah.
Thanks, Sophia.
Yeah.
That does make me feel better.
So, does Lily want to get some more purple paint so we can finish painting the rainbow?
Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, okay. We found the purple.
Yeah. Oh, and we found these really pretty flower stickers, too.
Oh, hey, look. This flower is a lily, just like your name is Lily. Did you know that the lily can be a sign of hope?
Oh, thanks. A lily. Hey, that means no matter where I am, there's always hope and love.
Aww. We love you, Lily.
Yes, we do.
We love you, too. Hey, maybe today could be a rainbow kind of day after all.
Yeah.
All right, so that was Lily and how they handled homelessness, okay? So next one is Cammy from South Africa. She is the Muppet with HIV. I should note that this particular clip is not from the show. It's actually from a spot that was made for UNICEF where Cammy is talking to President Clinton.
Mr. President, I have a very important question for you. What does a former Mr. President do?
Well, Cammy, one of the things I do is talk to people about things that are important to them.
Mm-hmm.
About things that will make a difference in their lives.
Oh, yes? Well, I do that also. I like to talk to people about my school and my friends and my favorite things. Oh, and I also talk to them about HIV and AIDS.
Me too, Cammy. Talking and listening and helping people learn about HIV and AIDS are two of the things I do a lot.
Really? Well, I also like to talk about my feelings with my friends and family when I am feeling sad or scared.
And I like to talk to parents about how important it is to listen to their children and how to help to take care of each other.
Yes. And do you tell everybody that it is okay to hug someone who is HIV positive like me?
I sure do, Cammy.
That makes me very happy.
Give me a hug. Make a difference. Talk to your children about HIV and AIDS.
All right, so that only leaves us with the last one of these, and that is Carly, the Muppet who is currently in foster care as her parents are in rehab.
My placemat, it's gone.
What?
Oh, I'm sure it's here somewhere, honey.
Yeah, don't worry, Carly.
No, I don't have a place.
Oh, sweetheart.
Carly, why is Carly so sad?
I don't really want to tell you about it.
She's having a hard time, Elmo. But we're here for her. We're her for now parents. Hey, Carly. Hey, we know some things are hard to talk about, but we're listening. Why don't we go over there and have a chat for a second?
Okay.
Yeah.
Miss Dahlia?
Yes, Elmo?
What does for now parents mean?
Well, Elmo, sometimes
Even mommies and daddies need some help taking care of their children. Carly's mommy's been having a hard time, so we are her foster parents, or her for now parents. We will keep her safe until her mommy can take care of her again.
Well, when will Carly's mommy be back?
Well, we don't know for sure when that will be, but what we do know is Carly belongs here for now. We want her here with us. Carly, you have a place at our table.
You are safe. You are strong. There is a place for you here. You belong.
I am safe.
You are safe.
I am strong.
You are strong.
There is a place for you here.
I belong.
You belong.
Oh, Carly, look at your placemat was right under that pizza box the whole time. See? Carly does have a place.
You are safe.
I am safe.
You are strong.
So that gives you kind of an idea of how they've handled these topics over the course of their history. A lot more of these in more recent eras than in the earlier times, other than the whole racial integration thing, which was a huge topic, don't get me wrong, okay? But it seems like more often than not now they're finding new ways to handle difficult questions and difficult topics. Okay? The next case study in the packet is controversial topic, which is LGBTQIA+ representation. In recent years, the issue has led more to more children's TV to be altered than any other. It has tended to be issues around LGBTQIA+ issues, specifically portrayals of relationships and characters in media. Much of the censorship surrounding this issue gets enacted in foreign countries when shows are localized. This also has precedent in the U.S. with the localization of Sailor Moon, which accidentally turned a lesbian relationship into an incestuous one. We talked about that situation, the relationship of Sailor Uranus and Sailor Neptune. Okay? Shows have been developed in recent years that have had LGBTQIA+ representation built into them. Sometimes, as a framework, the entire show is built around, such as Steven Universe and She-Ra and the Princesses of Power. While many shows can only get away with it in closing seasons or episodes, more shows recently are being overt about the representation with the support of their broadcast platforms. Okay? Next is the extra resources in the packet. The exam packet includes a number of links to additional resources. One of them is a series of 5 articles from Impact Nottingham about LGBTQIA+ representation, covered 1 platform per article. There's 12 video clips which give samples from the shows that are affected by these issues. Okay, you take a look at that list, ranging from Gargoyles to The Owl House. Okay, now let's move on to the questions. All right, so the question 1 here. Among the reasonings that have been presented for considering children's programming to be controversial, issues of inclusion and marginalized populations tends to arise commonly throughout time. Whether it be Southern objections to Sesame Street's diverse neighborhood or modern issues that arise around LGBTQIA+ characters. What argument can be made for either side of the controversy? That is, what arguments are there for the inclusion of these characters and what arguments are there for their exclusion? What support does either side have for their argument and how sufficient is it? Okay? So, A good chunk of the packet needs to be read through and experienced to try to fully address this question. So look through Sesame Street article from the New Yorker, the Impact Nottingham articles, the articles from Extra and The Guardian also give you some perspectives on this. One helpful tip I can give you, a gateway to protest the presentation presenting LGBTQIA plus issues can be found by cross-referencing any of the shows mentioned in that section of the packet with the group 1 Million Moms. So we did just that in one of our Collaborate sessions, you may recall. We took a look at the issues 1 Million Moms have, and it typically boils down to they are always protesting stuff that involves LGBTQIA plus representation with the excuse of we don't want you jamming this agenda down our kids' throats. Okay? All right. So question number two, consider the Looper list of offensive episodes. Choose any of the episodes on the list and argue for its reintegration into the show in question. Why is the series harmed by its exclusion? What should be done to address the issues which banned the episode in the first place to allow it to be acceptable for broadcast? Okay? So in this case, what you're doing is arguing a way to reintegrate these episodes into their respective shows. Okay? So one thing you do is read through the Looper article and watch its accompanying video for clips from the offending episodes. So this is primarily going to be coming down to your own personal opinion. Come up with a justification for your argument as best you can based on the evidence present. Now, to help you with that, I do want to go ahead and play the video. So this is the video that comes with the Looper article.
We think of animated shows as harmless kids' fare, but that isn't always the case. Each of these cartoon episodes were so raunchy, so stupid, or so downright confusing that they were denied an audience entirely. From its 1994 debut, Gargoyles gained a devoted fanbase for its complex plots, fluid animation, and serious storytelling. As an action-adventure series chronicling the lives of gargoyles who come to life at night to protect the places and people they love, the series explored themes including frustrated love, urban crime, and corporate greed. This willingness to go to intense places made Gargoyles an enduring hit that lives on in cosplay and tie-in comics to this day. But in the minds of network executives, it also crossed the line. The season 1 episode, Deadly Force, is a passionate, albeit stern story about gun safety, in which fun-loving gargoyle Broadway accidentally shoots human detective Eliza with her own gun. She is badly wounded and barely survives emergency surgery, and Broadway goes on a frantic, guilt-ridden crusade against guns. Ultimately, a very important lesson is learned about the safe handling of firearms, but not before several seconds of Eliza with a bullet in her belly filled the screen. Deadly Force was pulled from rotation for a while, and subsequent airings on spin-off channels Toon Disney and Disney XD recut the scene so that only Eliza's anguished face is visible. Regardless, the Gargoyles team remains proud of the message they sent about gun violence in this episode, and stand by it as a thoughtful examination of firearms and their mishandling. Dexter's Lab was one of the biggest successes of 1990s animation, an irreverent send-up of everything from mid-century space-age ambition to Marvel action heroes. At the heart of it was Dexter, megalomaniacal child genius with a secret lab behind his bedroom bookcase, and Dee Dee, his goofy, tutu-clad sister. Their clashes defined many episodes of the show, and typically went to bizarre extremes. That's when Dexter sought to grow a beard to display his manliness after Dee Dee's teasing, or when Dee Dee inspired a crush in Dexter's arch-nemesis, Mandark. That sibling rivalry reached new heights in Dexter's Rude Removal. In this infamous episode, Dexter develops a Rude Removal system to remove Dee Dee's more irritating qualities. This backfires, and Dexter ends up creating two versions of himself and his sister, a polite, vaguely British pair, and a pair whose every other word is censored by profanity bleeps.
Where the f*** are we? Beats the f*** out of me!
Despite its completion, Dexter's Rude Removal never aired. Series creator Genndy Tartakovsky mentioned it from time to time, growing its legend until finally, it surfaced on late-night programming blog Adult Swim's website. Despite the fact that no curse word is ever actually uttered and censored, the mere fact of their existence was too much for delicate ears. Tiny Toon Adventures was known for its wry attitude toward cartoon conventions. Babs, Buster, and the rest of the Acme University gang regularly poked fun at the expectations and tropes of the medium, from subverting slapstick gags involving mallets and banana peels, to the contrasting iconic jokesters like Bugs Bunny and Daffy Duck with genteel mortarboards and academic robes as the university's professors. From the cartoon setting in a town called Acme Acres to characters' names like Mary Melody riffing off Warner Brothers' legendary Mary Melody's cartoons, the whole cartoon rests on a the foundation of metatextual ribbing, but that went a little off the rails with the infamously banned One Beer. Plucky Duck, Hampton J. Pig, and Buster Bunny go on a whirlwind bender when they drink beer for the first time, quickly plummeting from wide-eyed kids to stubble-chinned lowlifes.
You babes wanna hang? Or what?
Despite the fact that Buster opens the escapade by outright saying, in this episode, we're showing the evils of alcohol, and ending it by asking if they can do a funny episode tomorrow now that they've lectured the kids, One Beer was banned until 2013, when it was finally included in a DVD release. Let that be a lesson to animators across the globe. Don't try to teach valuable lessons. Cow and Chicken never pretended to be anything but crass. Its titular siblings, excitable second-grader Cow and hot-tempered fifth-grader Chicken, regularly got into trouble that made it clear that they were there to make kids laugh, not provide moral guardianship.
Chicken, that's a good way to lose a beak!
Shut up, Cow! Mind your own business!
Take, for example, their enemy Red Guy. He might have actually been the devil, but was most notable for not wearing pants. Among his many aliases were Officer Panskovsky, Mrs. Bearderia, Major Wedgie, and No Pants Dalion. No joke was too crude for this cartoon to indulge. There was, however, a limit the censors did not want crossed, and Cow and Chicken found it with Buffalo Gals, 7 solid minutes of lesbian jokes. Unsurprisingly, it faced resistance from network executives, although it lives on through the magic of the internet. Dudley Do-Right's Stokey the Bear was intended in the spirit of fun. Canada is roundly, if kindly parodied in the episode as the home of trees, lumberjacks, the firewood industry, and, well, not much else. Snidely Whiplash is doing his diabolical deeds to better barbecue his hot dogs. Stokey was meant to be very much a parody of Smokey of Only You Can Prevent Forest Fires fame, but hypnotized by Snidely into setting fires. All in good fun, right? Wrong. The US Forest Service wasn't too pleased with a spoof of their beloved mascot, in no small part because Smokey was created with a very particular purpose in mind, one the episode was deliberately muddling, understandable perhaps, especially given that the episode's final gag implies Stokey was responsible for the Great Chicago Fire of 1871. The episode was yanked, Stokey was snuffed, and it never saw airtime again. Batman the Brave and the Bold was a self-conscious tribute and recreation of Silver Age DC Comics. Bright, funny, and abashedly nonsensical. From the retro aesthetic to capers with titles like Invasion of the Secret Santas, Brave and the Bold was all about having a good and goofy time. Mostly, this resulted in kid-friendly hijinks of the laser guns and magical truth serums variety. But in The Mask of Matches Malone, Brave and the Bold got downright naughty. When they're caught sneaking into a nightclub, Huntress, Catwoman, and Black Canary think fast and perform Birds of Prey, a throwback toe-tapper about the men of the DC Universe that stuffs an innuendo into every other line. This ranges from Catwoman purring, "What a weapon, what a bang about Batman," the implication that Green Arrow doesn't always shoot straight, and a complaint about the Flash being just too fast. But what got the episode booted off the Season 2 DVD collection was a suggestive finger-waggle Huntress deploys when discussing Aquaman.
His little fish, less outrageous.
With a bit of reanimation to remove the telltale finger, it was included as a bonus episode on the Season 3 DVD, and thus everyone now knows all about the male members of the Justice League and their prowess, on and off the battlefield. Cast your mind back to 1987, and recall the Garbage Pail Kids trading card. Their success rested entirely upon the fact that they were utterly disgusting little artifacts of childhood grotesquerie, a perfect parody of the apple cheat goodness of the Cabbage Patch Kids. With such characters as Atom Bomb, Oozy Susie, and Snotwitch Sandra, they were pulling no punches when it came to grossing kids out and cracking them up. But the 1987 Garbage Pail Kids cartoon went too far for the US viewing audience, starring Split Kit, Plug Dwayne, Elliot Mess, Terry Cloth, and Patty Putty, the eponymous kids use their disgusting powers to save the day. Groups including Action for Children's Television and Christian Leaders for Responsible Television protested, however, and the show was yanked from the airwaves mere days before release. Though it did go on to air in other countries, it never saw the light of US viewership. The Garbage Pail Kids were, to be frank, dumped. The English-language dub of anime mega-hit Sailor Moon cut and censored so many things from the original Japanese version, it merits a video of its own. Many of these changes have become infamous. Sailor Uranus and Sailor Neptune, originally lovers, were changed to cousins, and multiple instances of implied nudity were scrapped. Before many of these now infamous choices were made, however, was Day of Destiny, the finale to Season 1. Originally a two-parter, Day of Destiny sees Sailor Moon and company storm the Evil Queen Beryl's Arctic Fortress. Her henchmen attack, and the battle quickly goes south. Sailors Mercury, Mars, Jupiter, and Venus all die on the ice, and Sailor Moon is forced to fight the supercharged Beryl on her own. Given that the original Japanese title of the first episode is Death of the Sailor Guardians, the tragic final battle, it is perhaps unsurprising that it was cut, and the finale reduced to one cobbled-together episode for the US market. While it wasn't outright banned, the original version was just too much for kids. 1990s playgrounds the world over found themselves beset by a new fad. It was called Pokemon, and it still has yet to release its grip on young minds. Kids just can't get enough of Pikachu, Squirtle, and the gang. But a rumor haunted the franchise early on, mutating as it passed from kid to kid. There was an episode, they whispered, that was banned. The internet was in its infancy, and no one had ever seen the fabled episode, and so the tales grew unchecked. Even today, you might hear a child whisper about a killer episode of Pokemon that no one has ever seen. Unlike other kid-spread legends, this one really did turn out to be true. Electric Soldier Porygon is the episode in question, and it was indeed banned from the airwaves for reasons of public health. Hundreds of Japanese children were rushed to the hospital after it aired in 1997, suffering from seizures, convulsions, and vomiting. It turned out that a brief moment of bright, strobing animation induced this illness and set off a generation's favorite bit of gossip. 20 years later, it still fascinates us, though luckily, those prone to seizures know to keep well away. The Powerpuff Girls was never a show content to be normal. The very premise itself, man combines sugar, spice, everything nice, and the mysterious black ooze creates triplets, is bizarre. And episodes hinged on everything from elaborate Beatles parodies to the sinister effects of glue consumption. But in Season 5's See Me, Feel Me, Know Me, this was taken to new heights. In an homage to rock operas like Tommy, the episode is a sung-through musical in which the girls meet a magical gnome who promises to vanquish all evil in exchange for their powers. And he makes Townsville into a cult. Eventually, the day is saved, Townsville is restored, and the gnome is defeated. So why did Cartoon Network keep the episode off US airwaves? Questions swelled for years until show creator Craig McCracken finally provided some answers via his Tumblr. They banned it because they claimed that the metal beams in the destroyed buildings looked too much like crosses, and one of the hippies looked like Jesus. The staff was surprised and the fans were deprived, but it all worked out in the end. The episode is now available to anyone who wants to watch it on Hulu, iTunes, or on the original series DVDs. Anime exploded into popularity in the late 1990s, and Toonami, a Cartoon Network programming block aimed at the action-hungry after-school crowd, was a huge part of why. From Sailor Moon to Dragon Ball Z, Toonami aired the coolest, edgiest, often weirdest cartoons Western kids had ever seen, and it kept them glued to their TVs. New episodes appeared daily, movie-length specials were hyped for weeks prior to airing, and occasionally, Toonami even pushed the boundaries of what was considered acceptable. Action was tougher, faster, and more intense on Toonami, and jokes were a bit more edgy. Outlaw Star, a spacefaring action series, often pushed that line. But one whole episode was deemed unacceptable, impossible to edit into suitability, and unceremoniously dumped. It's no surprise as to why. Hot Springs Planet Tenrei sees hero Gene Starwin descend to a world of beautiful saunas filled with even more beautiful and always enclosed ladies. In the end, kiddie viewers just had to deal with the lack of continuity. Until many years later, it aired on the late-night reimagined Toonami, intended for just those kids who'd love it the first time around.
All right, so that's the Looper perspective on it. Okay? So take a look at question 3 now. Place yourself in the role of the parent of an 8-year-old child of either gender. Your child has been watching Steven Universe off and on depending on the broadcast schedule, but the night you decide to watch the show is the night the episode Reunited airs, depicting a lesbian wedding. Argue for or against your child continuing to watch the show. For what reasons are you making the decision for your child? How much does the background of the series or other episodes of it play into your decision? Okay? Now, this is, again, the role-playing question. It's going to be informed by your own personal reaction to the material in question. Just a quick aside here, I mentioned in the Collaborate session that the inspiration for this question was that my daughter had started watching Steven Universe. In the subsequent weeks since I talked about that, actually it was the other day, I also discovered that she had, on her own, has picked up another show that was mentioned in this packet as causing these LGBTQ controversies, and that is The Owl House. Okay? She started watching it on her own. So I'm kind of proud of her for that, and I'm also, again, do not have an issue with her watching it, just like I don't have an issue with her watching Steven Universe. I've watched the show myself, and I think it's got a fairly good message to it. Okay? So... that's just my opinion, though. Your opinion is what's going to inform your answer to this question. As a means of gaining perspective, part of the reason why the wedding was so significant was because of the realistic portrayal of the relationship between the participants. Okay, so we do have that video I showed you of Ruby and Sapphire's relationship, how it was portrayed all through the show. Okay, another element that will help to inform this response is background on the show's creator, Rebecca Sugar, and some of her goals for the series. So we have an hour-long interview with Rebecca Sugar here, and I just want to try to give you an idea of what kind of stuff they're talking about. So let me play this real quick. We'll just do some highlights from it.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Sugar. I'm here to talk about all things Steven.
Well, Rebecca, thanks so much for sitting down and chatting. It's so great to sit down with you.
Yeah, you too. As a teen artist on the internet, I learned very quickly to not engage.
Talking about Steven now, you're here at Cartoon Network, you're working on Adventure Time. When did the seed for Steven come? What was like the first idea for Steven? Has it always been with you, and then you finally had the opportunity to pitch it? How did it kind of come to be?
Well, a little ways into Adventure Time, people at the studio became aware of my writing, and I think also my songwriting, because I started writing more and more songs. I think I ended up writing 17 songs for the show. I think it's 19 now, because I came back to write two more. So people were familiar with that. And so Curtis Lelash asked me to, if I wanted to pitch an idea, and I very much wanted to do that. I had always dreamed of having my own show. And so I didn't have the Steven idea really before I was asked, but the drawings of Steven, I'd been drawing, Steven's based on my brother, and I'd been drawing my brother since our childhood. I would always draw pictures of Steven.
Yeah.
And I liked the thought of having everything revolve around that, because we'd grown up drawing together, coming up with ideas and working with Steven and doodling Steven. These were all sort of blended in my mind. And so I wanted to make something that felt like our childhood watching stuff and drawing stuff together.
Yeah, yeah.
So I liked the thought of having him at the center of it. But one of my thoughts was, Steven is very Zelda influenced, specifically Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask, which we used to play together. But that character, like Link in those games, would always be Steven, because he'd be playing. Yeah, I liked the thought of him actually being the central character, because in a way he always was in those fantasy stories.
Yeah.
So that's where I started. And then all of the fantasy elements of it, sci-fi elements of it, were all built around, it's a pastiche of the things that we used to enjoy and draw when we were younger.
Yeah.
So that was what I started with him, and then I went out from there, and each of the gems became a manifestation of some aspect of our relationship that we had with each other. So me being sort of able to be super free and casual around him, the ways that I would be sort of frustrated and overprotective and know-it-all around him, and also the sort of role model that I wanted to be for him, those each just got separated out into a character.
Absolutely. But just like kind of going back to the start of the series, when you were talking about, you know, having this vision of unfolding slowly, when you started the series, did it take a while before you knew what the series was, or where did you always have an idea of where you're going? Like, oh, I want to get to this place eventually. And did it take, I guess it's, you always see season one of shows feel very different than, like, you feel like they hit their stride like season two and three. Is that the same way in like animation?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Yes. I think one thing I also understood from Adventure Time is that the crew really makes the show. That the show creator, you know, they're setting the tone, they're setting things in motion, they're approving everything, but that the people whose hands are on the stories, the people who can give it the most attention, are the people that are writing and drawing it. And so I, honestly, at the very beginning, before we were staffed up, I actively tried not to tie things down too much. I had a lot of plans, even from the pilot. I had everybody's fusions, I had doodles for characters that wouldn't show up until episodes after 100, you know. But I had a point, but I didn't have all of the details because I wanted to create that together. So there were certain things that came, really pivotal things that came later as we discussed it as a group. I think one of the biggest ones was the idea that Amethyst came later, that she was from the kindergarten. We came up with the concept of kindergartens together as a team. You know, I sort of had the characters and their dynamics, but we really filled out the lore. And this was still early on. This was still back in 2013 that we were doing all of this as a team. But I wanted to make sure that we had created everything as a group so that when we all split up and made these different parts of it, that it was ours.
Yeah.
You know, that we all had a stake in making it be what it is, and all were excited about how it was going to be doled out. And all felt like we were inside of it too. I didn't want it to just be my childhood with Stephen. I also wanted it to be Ian's childhood.
Mm.
You know, I wanted there to be elements of Jeff's childhood and Lamar's childhood and Kat's childhood. Everybody, you know, should have a home in it, is how I felt. Especially because a lot of us loved animation, but didn't actually, and we all aspired to make it, but we hadn't really had shows that felt like the lives we'd experienced growing
up.
Exactly,
yeah.
So, and some of that I think has been the most challenging part of making the show, is talking not only about the wonderful things about our childhoods, but also some of the really uncomfortable realities that many children face that just normally are not addressed.
Yeah.
Even though we're addressing it through metaphor, there are a lot of children, I think there were a lot of things when I was young, for example, really, really casual anti-Semitism that I would experience when I was young. There was nothing like that in the cartoons I was watching, not as a metaphor, not as a surface level, I mean, anything.
Yeah.
And it would be really isolating, you'd think, and sometimes you don't have other kids to talk about it with either. And certainly, as a queer kid, I had nothing to go on.
Yeah.
I had no idea that any of the things that I felt at the time were relatable, that anyone else was experiencing that. I didn't really get to learn that until I was 27 or 28 and people were watching the show and saying, I felt just like that. I, as a kid, I'd had no access to any sort of understanding that could be a part of a childhood. I think all of those things do matter a lot. I think that when you're a marginalized kid and there's not a lot of content being made by marginalized adults, there's a very specific kind of isolation that you feel. And especially with something as innocuous as cartoons,
right.
You know, that are just always in your living room and always in your house, to feel connected to those, but also feeling like I was personally an alien in a lot of ways, in the ways that I didn't connect with these things, or connecting with the wrong things, I think, especially as a kid, because I always liked the wrong shows. I never liked any of the shows for little girls. Yeah, I always liked the shows that were aggressively marketed at little boys.
Yeah.
And I lived with an understanding that that was totally incorrect, which was very confusing. And that was a big goal early on with Steven, was to make sure that when kids were watching it, they never felt like it wasn't for them. Like it was like there was never a signal that said, If you're this type of kid, this isn't technically for you. Even though the advertising still has to categorize everything that way, technically the show was designed or is marketed towards 6 to 11 year old boys. Our demographic was 6 to 11 year old boys. That was the only group we were supposed to care about.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing that was interesting for me was that I liked shows for 6 to 11 year old boys.
Yeah.
So I was going to get to make the thing that I wanted.
Yeah.
But part of that, I wanted to also, as I was making that, say to the little me, you are also supposed to be watching this.
Yeah.
This is not for you.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, it's for them, but that's because that's what you like. You know, that seems fair, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. There's a, in the conversation about, I think, making more and more media for marginalized youth and helmed by marginalized creators. Which early on Steven, I felt like that's what we were doing. I was like, you know, anyone can relate to Garnet, anyone can relate to Amethyst, anyone can relate to Pearl. You know, everyone in our demo will be able to relate to these characters. But what I realized is that as a kid, I had been trained to relate to everyone, but a lot of people were, you know, when I was like, I want to be Batman,
right.
You know, I could make that leap and be like, well, in a lot of ways, this character isn't me, but I don't have a me, so I'll, you know, I like this, you know, but I think making Steven, what I really slowly realized, not only is it true that anyone can relate to these characters, but that I had not had the experience of just having someone who really I could really put myself into in such a direct way.
Yeah. Well, Rebecca, thank you so much for sitting and chatting. This was so enlightening and fun and getting to hear your story. So appreciate sharing.
Sure. Thanks.
All right. So, again, not giving you the whole interview there. It's really long. It's exactly an hour long. But that gives you kind of an idea of where she was coming from when she created the show, what kind of evolution it went through, and stuff like that. Okay? If you want to watch the full interview, just follow the link in the slides, and it'll take you there. That gets us to question number 4. It has been written about some of the shows with LGBTQIA+ themes, that their conflict resolution practices demonstrated in them are decidedly queer because they don't tend to rely on violence or having a winner than in straighter shows. For example, Steven Universe does a lot of stories with nonviolent conflict resolution through empathy and communication, while She-Ra and the Princesses of Power's final climax had the entire universe saved by an admission of love from Catra to Adora. Argue for or against similar conflict resolution techniques becoming a standard of children's television. How does this approach contrast with other popular shows currently on the air or in the past? Would this approach create more or less controversial episodes that could be banned? Concept presented is examined in the extra article. It specifically talks about this sort of thing. To a certain extent, it's also covered by Impact Nottingham. So you want to take a look at their articles as well. And I got a couple examples of this form of conflict resolution. In week 12, I did play these, so I'm not going to play them again. But one of them was the Monster Steven versus Crystal Gems scene from the second to last episode of Steven Universe Future. And then the other one is the final climax of She-Ra and the Princesses of Power. Okay, so... Alright, so that does it for these slides. That does it for the final exam review, and that does it for the class, okay? Now, again, there's going to be a collaborate session on Thursday. That'll be a question-answer session, pretty much strictly question-answer. I'm not going to go through any slides. It's just basically ask me what you need to know, okay? By the end of this week, you should have your proposal essay done. You should have your weekly discussion board responses done. You should have MindTap done. Again, everything comes due on the 4th, okay? If you're correcting any past essays, I need those in on the 4th as well. And then next week will be the final exam. Make sure you and your proctors are ready to do it. Unlocks at midnight on Monday and locks up again at 11:59 p.m. on Thursday, okay? And basically... with that being said, all I want to do is thank you guys for handling this with me throughout this entire semester. I know it's kind of been a difficult thing to deal with. Some people have had better luck than others, but we made it through together, and I appreciate all of you who participated in the class. I appreciate all you guys who stuck with me, viewed all these lectures, came to the collaborate sessions, everybody who did their part, okay? So thank you sincerely, and thank you for watching this. Finals week to next week. Thanks for attending the class.